Our next case is a 53-year-old female, previous history of mild asthma, but otherwise healthy. She underwent a cholecystectomy in 2009 and was also diagnosed with a 3.2-centimeter large cyst in the left kidney. She is now hospitalized due to acute pancreatitis and a slightly elevated bilirubin. The abdominal ultrasound showed a CBD of 9 millimeters and normal intrahepatic bile ducts. MRI could not be performed due to claustrophobia, and the patient is now referred for an EUS.
We are ready here.
Okay, that's fine. You have perhaps already the ultrasound image. So you heard the history of the patient. In these cases, it's always important to look, has the patient any cholestasis? And yet you can do it on two ways. You can begin in the intrahepatic ducts, or you can directly go down to the common bile duct. I looked first to the liver. You see the left liver lobe, so the longitudinal scanner is directed to the to eventually, so you see the left liver lobe, and now I make rotations with the instrument, and you have always to look that your instrument is straightened, otherwise the transducer will not move within the body. So you have a look to the left liver lobe. You see here the liver veins, and you see the portal veins here inside with a very typical echo-rich border. And close to them, you see very small intrahepatic ducts, bile ducts. So you can say there's no intrahepatic cholestasis. So you have the possibility now to rotate the instrument along the left liver lobe to the hilum here. This is the portal vein. We can put the color Doppler inside. And with the longitudinal scanner, it's sometimes very easy to see the higher part of the common bile duct, the proximal part, and the middle part of the proximal of the common bile duct behind the portal vein. You see, this is the portal vein here. Oh, excuse me, I have to.
We have it in color.
And this one is the common bile duct. So you can see that the common bile duct is really dilated. So I take out the color Doppler, so it's easier to see the common bile duct behind the transducer, behind the portal vein. This I want to measure it, and you see it's 14 millimeters, more than 40 millimeters. So this is clearly dilated. So it's pathology. Yeah. So we have to have a look whether she has this dilation later on. So this may be as well here parts of the cystic duct here after cholecystectomy. So now I rotate the instrument more to the level of the pancreas, and I try to demonstrate you the pancreas itself. I have again difficulties to come down. This patient has a hernia, and sometimes it's difficult to go downwards to the pancreas. In this case, I use the endoscopic view and go give a little bit air and go downwards completely in the stomach. Then I empty the stomach again from air, and now I retract the instrument in order to find the pancreas again. So the instrument is now straightened, and you are not it's not rolled up in the hernia. So I retract the instrument now more and more in order to find, especially for example, the splenic vein and splenic artery, splenic vein and splenic arteries. So now I am coming at the level of the pancreas. Here is the aorta, and you see here the pancreas. This is the must be the splenic artery here, and you see a little bit artifacts here. Close to the pancreas, and so this happens sometimes if you have a necrotizing pancreatitis. So the necrosis may make artifacts. So this is the pancreas. We enlarge a little bit the image. So, and the pancreas is a little bit inhomogeneous. This is the pancreas here, pancreatic body. And I rotate now to the tail. You can follow the pancreatic duct. You see the pancreatic duct here inside. So this is the tail of the pancreas. It's a little bit heterogeneous, but you have no major criteria concerning if you look at the Roseman classification. No calcifications, no irregular pancreatic duct, no stones within the parenchyma, no ductal stones. So now I rotate a little bit to the left side and go to the right side of the body. So this is the splenic artery. This is the splenic vein. I try to show you perhaps the splenoportal confluence. I don't know whether it's possible. Sometimes in these obese patients, it's as well difficult to find the confluence. It must be somewhere here at the level. Here, where the supramesoteric vein is coming from caudally, so this must be the splenoportal confluence. It's a little bit difficult to see. So this is the pancreatic duct surrounding the confluence. The head of the pancreas goes around the confluence downwards to the duodenum, and therefore you can follow as well the pancreatic duct downwards to the duodenum. So I think the next step will be to look how is the view from the duodenum. So for the passage into the duodenum, I have to fill air in the stomach, and I go downwards. Now you will see perhaps the pylorus. There's a pylorus, some erosion, small erosions in the antrum.
And can we see the endoscopic image as well?
Do you have the endoscopic image now?
There are only a few situations where we want to see the endoscopic image.
Yes, I wait a little bit.
This is one of them.
I think we have a little bit of time.
Yeah, there's no problem.
Okay, so this is the pylorus here, some erosion, so a little bit gastritis. So I pass through the pylorus and move downwards into the duodenum. Now I have to straighten the instrument like in ERCP. And now I fill the balloon. You see, now you are looking from the right side of the body to medially.
Now the ultrasonic image. Can we get that?
The file. So normally, if you have straightened the instrument, you have two possibilities. You are looking from the right side to left, so from right lateral to medial. This is the aorta. So you know your transducer is directed more dorsally. So you make a longitudinal section from the side through the aorta. So this is the third part of the duodenum here. This is a lower duodenal knee. Do you see the Kerkring folds here? So close to the transducer is the cava, inferior cava, and the aorta is a little bit far away from it. So now I retract the instrument and rotate the instrument more to the right, so it moves to more ventrally, and you see normally always here the mesenteric vessels.
Ike, I see you also use the balloon.
Yes.
But this is more to anchor your transducer.
Yes. Yes.
So that it won't slip too far back.
Yes, to fix it, yes.
Back.
So yeah. I love the balloon. So I think it's much more better, especially for the beginner, yes, to have a stable position in the duodenum.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Now we enlarge a little bit the image, and I retract now the instrument in this position. You see I'm rotated to the right, and I follow now backwards along the mesenteric vessels and try to find the common bile duct, the ecopure ventral part of the pancreas is here. You see the ventral part here. This is the ventral part.
Duodenum.
Yes, the duodenum. This is the duodenal wall here. This is the mucosa. And now I rotate a little bit to the left side. Okay. So this is the typical image of the common bile duct here.
This, just in front,
this is the pancreatic duct.
Pancreatic duct.
And this is the common bile duct. So this is the muscle, a very typical image of the papilla muscle. There's no
but it's
stone.
It's really dilated. It's dilated till the very end.
Yes. So I think we measure it again. So it's eight millimeters. So you can say.
What we might say here is that she has had a cholecystectomy performed. Yes. So we would accept up to 9, maybe 10 millimeters.
10 millimeters
of
yes,
common bile duct. So actually, what looking at here at the papilla level of the papilla is a normal dimension to this one. It was dilated up to 13 millimeters. Well, one didn't see on the abdominal ultrasound, but here it's a normal diameter.
But I think it's as well very interesting to see the interruption of the proper muscle layer from cranial side and from the caudal side by the papilla. This is the very typical image of the papilla muscle, yes? And the muscle is going very often a little bit in the common bile duct. This is normal. This is no pathology. Sometimes in adenomyomatosis you can have similar images, but this is a normal image of the distal common bile duct. So I retract a little bit the instrument together and rotate the instrument a little bit to the left side in order to
anti-clockwise rotation.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you see, I think it's very good to see that there. This is the. You see the lumen of the common bile duct here through the papilla here. This is very normal. It's symmetric. There's no tumor. Very typical image. So I try to follow anti-clockwise the common bile duct. You see a cystic duct now here.
Orifice of the cystic
this is
duct
cystic
running
duct
into
here.
The common bile duct.
And this is the common bile
duct. Cystic duct.
So you can now sometimes you lose the position a little bit if you go over the level of the upper duodenal knee, and you see sometimes here the pylorus, which is compressed by the balloon. So this is the complete common bile duct here now. And you can try, like in radial scanning, you can try to adapt a little bit the section plane by rotating the small wheel a little bit to the right side and fix this with a thumb. Then you get a better image of the common bile duct. So you have now the common bile duct together with the cystic duct. There's no stone inside. This is the common hepatic artery here. We take the color Doppler inside. Enlarge the window a little bit. So you see the common bile duct has no flow inside. And I can follow now completely the common bile duct backwards. By rotation to the left side, now it gets bigger and bigger. So this is a cross section now. So we are coming now at the level of the liver hilum. So a better penetration is good, but I take a little bit more gain. So we can say there's the common bile duct is dilated, but we have no reason for it. We have no bile duct stone. We have no tumor. We have a little bit signs of heterogeneous pancreas, but no major criteria for a chronic pancreatitis. I think that must be enough for this case.
Yeah, I think you're quite right. Actually, when we schedule patients with this kind of indication, we always have the patients on the table for the ERCP, and we can immediately go on with the ERCP and solve the specific.
But she must have had necrosis. This is very typical. These artifacts here.
Can we see the ultrasonic?
But
image,
Peter,
we don't.
Might say here, this is a very elegant case on the case of patients having claustrophobia and also have the suspicion of stones. Then what we I could just demonstrate is how elegantly you can show much better actually than the MRCP whether there are stones, but whether there are stones or not, and then you can, as you said, Peter, continue directly to the ERCP and thereby both saving time and also money by only performing one examination, one general anesthesia. So I think in this case, then we haven't got the reason for the pancreatitis. It could be a past stone, but it could also be due to lifestyle habits, but we're told to shut down now.
So this is the necrosis here, and you see the artifacts behind it. So it's an organized necrosis, already organized necrosis. Perhaps this as well here. So it's not normal that you have such a heterogeneous surrounding of the pancreas here in the bulsa.
Okay. We thank you for a nice presentation, and I think it's time for coffee.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.